Friends, welcome to today's auditing class. First, what we'll do, we'll be learning a new concept, that is the concept of materiality. You might be knowing about this concept earlier, is it not? Some of you might be having some idea about the concept of materiality because many times earlier also we have discussed that there should not be any material error or material fraud in the financial statement. If the financial statement contains some material misstatement, which may be due to error or due to fraud, then financial statement is not showing true and fair view. Is it not? This is the normal concept we are aware of. Yes or no? I repeat. If in order to show, or you can say the financial statement cannot show true and fair view, if it contains a misstatement or material misstatement, which may be due to error or due to fraud. Okay. Now, what is that? Here you see the concept of materiality is important at this point of time. How to know this particular misstatement is material or not? That is what we are going to discuss today. I'm going to share the screen with you right now. In fact, the concept is related to standards at auditing 320. Screen is visible to you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. You see, the financial reporting framework many times has discussed about the concept of materiality. And you know, the concept of materiality is important in the context of preparation of financial statement as well as presentation of the financial statement. Okay, so few things we'll be understanding to understand the concept of this thing, materiality. First of all, few points. Point number one, let us see. Misstatements, including omissions, are considered material if they're individually or in aggregate could reasonably be expected to influence the economic decisions of the users. That means here we are talking about users of the financial statement. So if the financial statement contains some misstatement or financial statement contains some omission and which is reasonably expected to influence the economic decisions of the users, so what kind of conclusion we'll draw? Conclusion will be that these misstatements are material. Okay, it may be misstatements, it might be omission. And the concept of materiality has to be judged, as you can say, individually as well as aggregate. Individually, one item may not be significant or may not be material. But when it is considered in aggregate or when it is aggregated with some other items, if it can be regarded as material, or it can be expected, or it can be reasonably expected to influence the economic decisions of the users of the financial statement, we'll be considering that item as a material item. Okay? Did you understand this point? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Key word here is that item. Item means it might be misstatement or it might be omission. That should influence the economic decisions. Right, let us say one user of the financial statement, you are supposed to make investment. You are supposed to buy the equities of this company. Is it an economic decision or not?
Yes, sir. Okay.
And because of an omission, let us say he has decided not to invest. So whether that misstatement is materially, whether misstatement is influencing the economic statement, economic decisions or not?
Yes, sir.
it is influenced. It has been influenced. Right. So that is what, if a particular misstatement or particular omission has influenced the economic decisions of the users of the financial statement, that is material. And again, I repeat one more thing. This materiality has to be judged individually as well as in aggregate. Individually, that item may not be material, but as a group, that may be material. Right. So this is, you say, the key point. Or on the key basis of judging materiality. But you see, this judgment about the materiality has to be made in the light of surrounding circumstances. We have to keep in mind the surrounding circumstances, the size and nature of misstatements, or combination of both. What is the size of misstatement? Okay, right, let us say a small item is misstated. Let us say this thing, employee benefit expenditure or salary is less stated by 500 rupees. Will it be material misstatement? What do you feel? How will judge that this statement is material or not? Expenses under the head salary has been understated by rupees 500. Is it material? What do you say?
Yes, sir, it's material.
Yeah, you should not draw conclusions straight away like that. What you have to do, you need to consider the nature and size of the business. Let us say size of business is that, let us say, revenue is 5 crore. There, if you see 500 is immaterial. But let us say there is no revenue. Right. And because of this misstatement of 500, it affects the performance. That means loss may be converted into profit or profit may be converted into loss. So 500 may become material. So you have to keep in the mind the size and also nature of misstatement. Right? Nature of misstatement means, let us say, certain, disclosures are statutorily required. Or let us, you know, Companies Act requires to present the financial statement in a particular manner. Is it not? It has to be presented in a particular format. The format, where that format is provided, who can tell me?
Sir, Schedule 3 of Companies Act 2013.
Yes. If you look at the Schedule 3, you can find out various items. And the financial statements are expected to be presented in that manner. Right. Or let us say nature of the item is such that needs a specific disclosure. But the disclosure has not been made. Is it material? Here size doesn't matter. What it matters is that a statutory requirement has not been complied with. Are you getting?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'll be showing you various. I'll be showing you this thing, Schedule 3 format, and you can understand what are the things that needs specific disclosures. If the disclosure has not been made, then it is a non-compliance. So that is a material item. Let us say, for example, you assume cash and cash equivalent. What are the components of the cash and cash equivalents are supposed to be disclosed? If that has not been disclosed, then that non-disclosure or that misstatement will be regarded as material misstatement. Okay? Right. So this materiality issue needs to be judged on the basis of or in the light of surrounding circumstances, size of the financial statement, nature of the misstatement, and also combination of both. Okay, now, judgments about matters that are material to the users of the financial statement are based on consideration of the common financial information needs of the users. So as you know just now, how will be judging a particular item is material, a particular statement is material or not. We have to see whether it is affecting or whether it is influencing the economic decisions of the users. Right. While considering that point, we have to see the common financial information needs of the users. Some users might be having a specific need. That is different. But when you are preparing the financial statement in accordance with the financial reporting framework, right? So we have to give the common information needs of the users as a group. Okay, if that is material, so or you can say materiality point has to be just from the in the light of common financial information needs of the users. Did you understand this? That means some users, if they are having a specific requirement, that will not be considered. You have to consider the general requirement, the general expectations of the user on the financial statement. Are you getting me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, few more points in the red materiality we have to discuss. As you know, as an auditor, of course, the preparation of the financial statement is the responsibility of the management. Management is responsible to prepare the financial statement in accordance with the financial reporting framework. And management has to ensure that the financial statement does not contain any material misstatements. And as an auditor is concerned with the items which are either individually or as a group are material. Right. So audit in that means auditor is not concerned about immaterial items. As you know, auditor reports that the financial statement is showing true and fair view. Is it not true and correct view? True and fair view. That means there might be some misstatements in the financial statement. But in the opinion of the auditor, those misstatements are not material. Okay. But this is a difficult task. This is a very challenging thing to judge whether this item is material or not. And there is no defined rule that materiality has to be judged on this basis. Or there is no formula kind of thing, applying which you can judge whether this item is material or not. So it is difficult to define a standard for judging materiality. Right. Then how auditor will be able to judge this misstatement is material or not? Most of the cases, it is on the basis of auditor's professional experience and his judgment skill. You have to keep in the mind the surrounding circumstances, the nature and size of the financial item. And he has to use his professional experience and judgment. On that basis, he will be deciding whether this item is material or not. Okay. Now, few paragraphs, if you refer to essay 320, few paragraphs only we'll be covering here. So, the determination of materiality is a matter of auditor's professional judgment. And it is affected by auditor's perception on the financial information needs. Auditor feels that the general users of the financial statement has these needs. Or these are the items which are needed by the financial users of the financial statement. And if there will be a misstatement in these items, then it may influence their economic decisions. Okay, that is auditor's perception. Auditor might be thinking, okay, turnover is important. If there is a misstatement, it may influence the financial, influence the economic decision. Or profit is important. Or some expenditures are important. Or my asset position is important. Asset ratios are important. Right. All of them are important means material. And auditor may perceive that these are the things which are required by the uses of the financial statement. And on that basis, he exercises his professional judgment and tries to ensure that there is no material misstatement in those items. Okay? So perception is important. Auditor has to perceive that which are the items, which are the items required by the users of the financial statement. Okay, required in the sense, these are the items which users of the financial statement need to take economic decisions. Okay, are you getting?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, you see, now auditor has to perceive that thing. Since there is no fixed guideline, auditor has to perceive these are the items which are needed. And while perceiving this thing, the standards and auditing says that auditors can make certain assumptions. Few assumptions auditors can make. First is that the users have reasonable knowledge of business and economic activities. They know what is this, what kind of business is this, what kind of economic activities is going on. They have also reasonable knowledge of accounting and a willingness to study the information which is provided in the financial statement. So we'll expect that users have all these things. If the company has disclosed something, the users should be able to understand that disclosure. They should be able to relate that disclosure with a particular item of financial statement. So auditor may reasonably expect that or reasonably assume that users are capable of doing this. Okay. You can also assume that users understand the financial statement that are prepared, presented, and audited to levels of materiality. So material items should be understandable by the users. Okay. And also auditor can assume that users recognize the uncertainties inherent in the measurement of amounts. So in financial statement, what happens? Various items are recognized, measured, presented, and disclosed. Is it not? And when this measuring exercise is done, certain estimates are made. Let us say the management wish to measure what should be the provision for a bad debt. Okay, he has to estimate something. Okay, this much amount will be the, let us say, provision. Or management might have to exercise his judgment that, okay, life of the asset is this many years, accordingly, this will be the depreciation. And when estimates and judgments are involved, there will be some kind of uncertainties. So it is not certain. Estimation means it is not certain. Nobody can give guarantee that actual life of the asset will be that much. So auditors can assume that the users of the financial statement also recognize that there are uncertainties involved. And auditors can assume one more thing, that users are capable of making reasonable economic decisions on the basis of information provided in the financial statement. Right. So these are, you see, these four points are there. Can you see it? A, B, C, D.
Yes, sir.
Auditor expects that users are capable of doing all these things. They have reasonable knowledge. They're capable of making economic decisions. They can understand the financial statement. They can also understand the financial statement involves some estimations and judgments, which involve an element of uncertainties. They can also understand in this situation what should be the level of materiality. Okay. Auditor assumes all these things. On that basis, auditor perceives which are the items that are material. And on that basis, auditor forms an opinion whether the financial statement is giving true and fair view or not. Are you getting this point?
Yes, sir.
Understood this? How auditor decides the materiality level? And this is what we are learning. This is as per the standards and auditing 302 we are referring to. 320. auditing standards 320. I'm referring to just a minute. Yeah. Now, in the context of audit, one more thing we have to understand, that the concept of materiality is applied both at the planning stage and performance stage. Okay, the standards of auditing requires that the auditor should plan the audit engagement. Auditor should first plan, then perform the audit. Okay, while performing, auditor evaluates the effects of identified misstatement. You know, auditor verifies certain things, he checks the document, is it not? He does a verification. While doing verification, he may find out certain misstatements. He notes them down to find out, okay, these are the statements which are identified. Some of them might be corrected by the management and some of them may still remain uncorrected. So auditor considers, okay, these are the misstatements which are incorrect. Then he forms an opinion whether this affects the economic decisions of the users of the financial statement. Is it going to influence? On that basis, he plans and performs the audit. Okay, so materiality is important at planning stage as well as in performance stage. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now, first let us say at planning stage, how materiality is important. At this stage, did you understand the concept of materiality?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now you see, while auditor doing a plan, you have already seen how an audit program looks like. That is also a part of planning activity. Okay. So at planning stage, what auditor does, auditor makes judgment about the size of misstatements that will be considered material. Auditor decides, okay, this kind of organization, this is my materiality level, or I decide this is the size of misstatement. If this much of misstatement is there, it is tolerable. If it is beyond that, then it will be regarded as material. On the basis of his experience, auditor decides or auditor judges or fixes a materiality level. How he will judge? And on the basis of that judgment, auditor also determines the nature, timing, and extent of risk assessment procedures. Okay, I have not explained you what is the risk assessment procedures. I am giving you some brief idea at this stage. Later we'll be learning. So, you know, when you do audit, you have to follow certain procedures. Audit is a procedural thing or not? It involves certain procedures. Certain procedures are followed, certain techniques have to be applied. Okay. And this is risk assessment procedure, you can say, is a kind of procedure which is necessary in any audit situation. In fact, broadly, there are two kinds of procedures. Okay, second point you see here is, you can see one more category of procedure we are talking about. Can you read what is written here?
Sir, further audit procedure.
Okay. Audit procedures also we'll be learning very shortly. So now at this stage, you know, there are two kinds of procedures we are talking about. Risk assessment procedure. Second is further audit procedure. Okay. What is risk assessment procedure? When auditor starts the audit, okay, at the very beginning, so auditor assesses risk. Risk means what is the possibility that the financial statement may be material misstated. He tries to ascertain what are the risks involved in different areas. Okay, financial statement contains various items. Let us say as regards to assets, auditor makes a risk assessment. he found, okay, this is a very sensitive area, there is a possibility of misstatement. He may extend the audit procedures. Like this, in every area, auditor makes a risk assessment. Are you getting? He follows some procedure and makes a risk assessment. We call that procedure as risk assessment procedure. We'll be learning that in detail. And on that basis, he develops further audit procedure. If risk assessment is high, audit procedures may be extended. Further audit procedure may be extended. If risk assessment is less, then further audit procedure may be minimized. Are you getting? They're related. So first risk assessment procedure needs to be applied to find out which are the risky areas. Then further audit procedures have to be applied. Are you getting?
Yes, sir.
Now, the concept of materiality is important to decide or to determine the nature of audit procedures, nature of risk assessment procedure, timing of risk assessment procedure, and the extent of the risk assessment procedure, because risk assessment procedure has to be applied. Okay, through that procedure, auditor will identify and assess the risk of material misstatement. Okay, risk assessment procedures are applied and material misstatements, areas where material misstatements are possible, they're identified. Okay, after that only, auditor will determine the nature, timing, and extent of further audit procedures. Now you can see three-step procedures are there. Number one, risk assessment procedure. If risk is high, further audit procedures can be extended. If risk is low, further audit procedures can be minimized. Okay. Are you getting?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Now we'll not discuss further on this. Now we'll go to one more concept very quickly, that relating to materiality only. Just now we discussed about materiality or the importance of materiality as planning level, right? As you know, materiality is important as the level of planning, as well as at the level of at the performance stage also, at planning stage as well as at performance stage also, right? And what is the materiality at performance stage? At performance stage, that means when auditing is actually happening or auditor applies some further audit procedure. Here what happens, auditor decides the materiality level. Auditor may be fixing an amount. Okay, why he fixes that amount or why he decides that materiality level? He decides so that the probability of aggregate uncorrected or undetected misstatements, okay, should not exceed that level. Okay, so he decides a level in such a way that he decides the material level, he decides. And on the basis of that level, auditor tries to find out what is the probability of aggregate uncorrected or undetected misstatements. Auditor may assume, okay, the aggregate value of undetected or uncorrected misstatements will be 5 lakh. And now auditor decide, is it exceeding my materiality level, which I had fixed? If it will exceed, what is the probability? Is there 50% chance that it may exceed, or is there 80% chance it may exceed, or 20% chance it is exceed? Are you getting? So at performance level, materiality concept is important for taking this decision. That what is the probability that uncorrected or undetected misstatements may exceed the materiality level? If there is more chance that it may exceed, then auditor need to extend further audit procedures. So in such a way that the probability can be minimized. Are you getting or not?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now I think you got some idea that the concept of materiality is important at planning stage as well as at performance stage. Okay. And when applying risk assessment procedures, as well as applying auditing procedures, auditor takes into consideration the concept of materiality. Okay. At risk assessment procedures, auditor decides the nature, timing, and extent of these procedures. And on that basis, auditor tries to assess, identify, and assess the risk of material misstatement. And on the basis of that assessment, auditor determines the nature, timing, and extent of further audit procedures. Okay. Is it clear to you or you feel it confusing? Are you finding it confusing?
No, sir.
Okay, I'll try to help you. Just give me a moment with the help of some example, how practical it happens. Just give me a moment for that. Wait a minute, I'm trying to share with you a file. Well, friends, I'm going to share a file right now, which will show you application of risk assessment procedures. Yeah, are you able to see it now?
Yes, sir.
As you know, right now, materiality is important at planning stage as well as implementation stage. At performance stage. Okay. And auditor broadly use two kinds of procedures. Other procedures are there in detail. We have been seeing what kind of audit procedures are used. Compliance procedure, substantive procedure, etc. will be learning at advanced stage. But at this stage, I told you, one is risk assessment procedure. And what is the second one? Who can tell me? Further audit procedures. Okay. Right? Risk assessment procedure and further audit procedure. Risk assessment procedure, what happens? Auditor tries to see what is the risk involved in various transactions. Then accordingly, it extends the further audit procedure. Now you see in that example how it happens. Let us say this is a particular audit program. Here, risk is analyzed by applying some risk assessment procedures. Right, let us say item number 2, power purchase and sale. It is found risk is low. But when these items are tested, originally it is thought the risk is low. It is found there is a dispute with a company. So original extent of verification as per original plan was some sample testing was to be done. But because of this dispute, what has happened? Now verification extended, further audit procedures are extended. No, it is not sample, it is on 100%. You see another item, fixed assets. Okay, fixed assets, originally it is planned that risk is moderate risk, but it is found that fixed assets outing for disposal is not in line with ASTM. Okay, so there is some non-compliance are found. Then originally when it is planned test check, then it is revised. No, it is not test check, it will be 100%. So like this, you can see many places. Original plan was different. Original plan was something like this, but plan was revised. That means detailed audit procedures are there or detailed audit procedures are modified to ensure that that material misstatements are brought to a lower level or the risk that the financial statements are materially misstatements or risk that auditor gives an inappropriate opinion is brought to the efforts are made to bring that risk to a lower level. Did you understand this concept? The two things, what is risk assessment procedures and what is further audit procedures?
Yes.
Okay. Got it? Fine. Yeah, so this is the performance materiality we are discussing. And as we have already discussed that there is no fixed guideline or fixed formula to decide the materiality. Then how one can decide? On the basis of experience, this some points are there. These are only for guidance purpose. How to decide or how to judge materiality? First basis, maybe on the basis of amount. That means if you find the amount is big or the size is big, then that might item may be regarded as a material item. And certain statutory items of assets, liabilities, incomes, and expenditures. Let us, there is something wrong there. Maybe some statutory liability, let us say PF liability, or maybe this thing, liability as regards to employee benefit. Okay, maybe retirement plan benefit, etc. Or a liability on tax. So those are material items. And also certain items where disclosures are required. As I was giving you an example, that composition of cash and cash equivalents. Or how, what is the breakup of auditor's remuneration? These are the things where the law requires that they have to be specified in detail. Okay. Or items of expenditure which exceeds 1% of the revenue. The exceeding 1% of the revenue, as you, some of you might be knowing, the Schedule 3 requires that separately they have to be disclosed. 1% of the revenue or rupees 1000, whichever is higher. That means, suppose an income or expenditure, which is, let us say, 5 lakh rupees. So we have to see what is 1% of the revenue or 1 lakh rupees, whichever is higher. If this amount is exceeding that, then this income or expenditure should be separately disclosed. You should not include it under miscellaneous income. It should not explain it as a miscellaneous expenses. You have to separately write what is that expense, because that is material. So like this, you have to judge that which items are material or not. Have you ever seen Schedule 3? Schedule 3, have you gone through Schedule 3 of Companies Act?
No, sir.
No. I'm just showing you. You can get a very brief idea that how financial statements needs to be presented. This is Companies Act. You can also download Companies Act 2013 from the website of Ministry of Corporate Affairs. You can visit to mca.gov.in, download Companies Act 2013, keep it with you. You can refer them whenever you need. Oh, I need to go to Schedule 3. Now this is Schedule 4. So I have to go backward. You see, this is Schedule 3. I'm showing you part 2. Now I'm going to show you part 1. And as you know, the financial statement will show true and fair view if it is prepared in accordance with the financial reporting framework. That means there is a requirement that it has to be presented in this particular format. The financial statement has to be prepared in this format. Okay. Now you see, this is, I'm showing you Schedule 3, Schedule 3 of Companies Act 2013. Okay. So these are, this contains general instruction for preparation of financial statements. You can read it. Okay. How rounding up can happen in rupees, all these things are there. You can go through it. This is the format of balancing. Figures of the current reporting period, figures at the end of the previous reporting period. All these things are here. equities and liabilities. In this format, it is to be prepared. But what is important here is this general instruction for preparation of balance sheet. Okay. How current assets needs to be classified. If these instructions are not followed, so normally it will be considered a material violation, or you can consider it's a material mistake. Okay, certain items you see, reserves has to be classified like this. So it's a statutory requirement. If these items are there but not classified, there is a violation. Are you getting me? Long-term borrowings has to be classified like this. So detailed explanation should be there because this is a requirement of the law. Other long-term liabilities shall be classified like this, trade receivable and others. So this is the requirement that the items of the financial statement should be classified like this. Are you getting? Tangible assets should be classified under these heads, land, building. These are the requirements of law. This has to be followed. Intangible assets has to be recognized under this head. Okay, just have an idea. Another non-current assets, how that can be classified. Non-current investments. Inventories needs to be classified. You see, such a detailed manner, these things are there. So these things needs to be followed. Cash and cash equivalents shall be classified. Balance with bank, checks, cash in hand, and others. Then earmarked with bank, like this. All these things should be disclosed properly. Now coming to second part of the Schedule 3, the statement of profit and loss. This is the format in which this has to be presented. So as you know, Companies Act requirement, the financial statements should be presented in the form and contain which is prescribed. This has to be followed. You see, this is how detailed breakoff should be there for various items. Suppose finance cost, interest expenditure, other borrowing cost, all these things should be disclosed separately. Okay, you see various items, how this has to be disclosed. I wanted to show you one more thing. Now. So this is how this items of expenditure should be disclosed. Power, fuel, rent, repair, maintenance, building, insurance. Yeah, this item I wanted to show. You see, employee benefit expenditure should be shown separately. Depreciation amortization expenses should be shown. Now this item, can you read this item? Item C.
Sir, any item of income or expenditure which exceeds 1% of the revenue from operation or ₹1 lakh, whichever is higher.
This also helps us. This amount also helps us to decide the materiality level. We can decide what is 1% of revenue or 1 lakh rupees, whichever is higher. So that can be fairly considered as a material level. That can help us to judge what is the materiality level. Because if the item is like that, then separate disclosures are required. Okay. Got some broad idea about the concept of materiality? How they are decided? Okay. Again, I repeat, there is no fixed formula. On the basis of auditor's experience, one has to, on experience and professional knowledge, one has to decide what is the materiality level in different situations. Okay. Any query you have?
No, sir.
Well, Now, friends, now what we'll do, we'll stop here and we'll catch up after 15 minutes with a new lesson. So I'm leaving you a little early, in fact. So we'll rejoin maybe around 2:10. 2:10 we'll be rejoining and continuing the other concepts. Okay, we'll stop here and we'll catch up after 15 minutes. Thank you very much.